we at the ACC. This week in 1976, Heaven Must Be Missing an Angel by Tavares was number 6 on the Billboard Dance Club Song Charts. Shaggers were and still are dancing to it.
Thinking. Salem, Greensboro.
Classic country.
Well, some extra clouds out there this afternoon. Our temperature's topping off in the mid-70s. That'll be it. We'll keep in the spotty showers and drizzle from time to time today. Tonight, some fog, some drizzle around occasionally. Overnight lows of 65. And then for Sunday, high temperatures into the upper 70s on Sunday afternoon. And a chance for some scattered showers and maybe an isolated thunderstorm on Sunday, too. Monday, showers and thunderstorms. A little warmer, a high of 83 for Monday.
Classic country, WP. Find me a new way to light up an old flame. With a little bit of luck and a hug, there's gonna be a big change. I got a strong desire to start the kind of fire that'll burn through a pouring rain.
10-9-8.
Yo, this is Sue Kamara from Richmond, Virginia, fifth year senior.
Yo, this is Boogie Basham from Roanoke, Virginia, fifth year senior, and this is Across the Quad.
Dude, bro, in the locker room, who you think is the best DJ when we that be playing music with?
Honestly, I say myself. You know, I got different flavors.
Yeah.
You know, after awakening, practice. Either I just a little workout, you know, guys are in that hype. So I feel like I do a great job of mixing, maxing the music for different guys on the team, honestly.
Yeah, that is true. I can give you that one. You pretty good DJ, you know. You turned us up this morning, too.
Yeah.
And the indoor, I like that. Got me a little hype to go. You do got a lot of flavor. So, I mean, I give you that one. I think you top two best DJs.
we resolve to do more. To listen, understand, and act. To make healthcare simpler. To nourish our communities. And stand against racism.
All eyes of the college football world are on Wake Forest and Clemson here at Winston-Salem. As the Demon Deacons host the top-ranked Tigers and a national television audience with the ACC swinging into full gear after a summer of uncertainty amid the COVID-19 pandemic. ESPN sent the college game day crew. All eyes of the college football world are on Wake Forest and Clemson here at Winston-Salem. As the Demon Deacons host the top-ranked Tigers and a national television audience with the ACC swinging into full gear after a summer of uncertainty amid the COVID-19 pandemic. ESPN sent the college game day crew here for the first time ever, underscoring the national implications of the 86th ever meeting between these longtime ACC rivals. Wake Forest is in the midst of a very fruitful time under the direction of seventh-year head coach Dave Clawson, who has guided the Deacons to a school record four consecutive bowl trips. Redshirt sophomore Sam Hartman is the starting quarterback. One of the best ever to wear the Wake uniform on the defensive side of the ball is defensive end Carlos Boogie Basham.
He gets hit hard.
It's off the edge, and Lawrence gets bottled up behind the line. And coming back to help out the quarterback is Kendall Hinton. Lawrence throws one across his body and trying to avoid the rush of Carlos Basham.
So the national stage is set for Wake Forest and Clemson and the ACC, as the Deacons and top-ranked Tigers lift the curtain.
Football is back, a time that we maybe not have seen it. Well, it's back, and hello and welcome to Truist Field, and hello to all you fellow season ticket holder fans. I'm Ty Collins, live from Deacon Tower. Delighted to have you here virtually, but you know who's not here virtually? ESPN College Game Day. 1987 was the debut. It was Lee Corso, it was Tim Brando, and the late Beano Cook who started the infamous, if you would say, Game Day that has now been in our living rooms since 1987. 33 years till they finally make their way to Winston-Salem here in the beautiful town of Winston-Salem, the great Campbell City. So if you think about it, those 33 years, when that opened up in 1987, when Grove Stadium, which means so much to me as a fan, playing touch football behind the away sidelines during halftime, to even right now, where a grown man and bringing my four-year-old son. And if you go all the way back for the first season opener for the ACC in week one, you have to go back 16 years. 2004, Wake Forest went down to Clemson and lost in overtime, but if you remember, Ben Mauch went big time. His first time as a Demon Deacon, went 85 yards, bombed to Jason Anderson. Of course, they end up losing that 37-30, but that was a bit of a thrill. And, of course, the rivalry has always been Clemson, Wake Forest, old gold and black, still gold and black. 16 years later, here we are in Winston-Salem, the number one Clemson Tigers are here again. You're going to see Trevor Lawrence, who – right now, we'll, let's be honest, we'll be the number one pick in the NFL draft. Have to go back to 2009 where we saw Andrew Luck and Robert Griffin III play right here at Truist Field. Two titles and four seasons, Clemson Tigers, they have become a juggernaut of the ACC, and that only loss came last year. Well, it wasn't even last year. It was actually 2020 when they lost to LSU in the Mercedes Superdome down in Louisiana for the championship. Of course, the blood is in the water. They want revenge. They got Travis Etienne back. And, of course, Trevor Lawrence is QB1. Wake Forest 7-1, 2019, before they headed off to Virginia Tech. And those injuries kind of showed their ugly head. They went one game, one win for the last five games. They bring back two returners there on starters. But let's be honest, Sam Hartman, he's pretty much a starter. He started in 2018 as a freshman. Well, now he is behind the center once again and will be doing the duties as captain to lead this Wake Forest team against the number one Clemson Tiger team. I also had a chance to watch them in practice this week. Sam Hartman with his his dark long hair, which if you go back to his high school years, that's when he had a really good season. So with his long hair, I think we've got some maybe good omens. So we looked at practice video earlier this week when we saw how they would really adapt to playing this number one team. Of course, you have a lot of question marks. No wide receivers, no Sage Surratt, but you do have Donovan Green, who's back, who's going to be a phenomenal player on the outside as a wide receiver. And, of course, Kenneth Walker, who we saw last year, who can run the rock up and down the field. But Sam Hartman, it's the Sam Hartman Show, and we look forward to seeing what he can do because we saw that in 2018, unfortunately, with the injury. Didn't quite work out the way we want to, but he's a starter. He's the captain. Let's take a look at the practice video this week.
Let's get it. Compete. All camp. Let's work. Let's get it, man. Things on three. Things on me. One, two, three.
Allow me to show you the future. All 11. First time in the studio, no session. I was in the pop, that's a confession. Then God pushed me for the pro session. Hey, hold up, watch a 116 videos. Try and rap just like Mini-O. Whatever can't save my life. But he ain't really with the word hero. OMG, I believe what I can't see. I still got these memories when wasn't no kid trying to be like me. Wait a minute, whoa, I don't even know my limits, whoa. And ain't no pretending, whoa. Catching Z's and finna get whoa. Long as I got breath, this is just beginning, whoa. This is where we separate all the sheep from the goats.
Let's take a trip. They said this would happen.
We are next. Ay, we up next. Yeah, we up next. Ay, we up next. We up.
Well, they're hype, and of course we are too. Let's go ahead and send it off to our other part of this team, Brianna Norwood, who's got more on the stadium changes due to COVID-19.
Thanks, Ty. Again, so excited to be here at Truist Field. I actually graduated in 2017 and from Lake Forest, and I was also a football manager, so I know this field really well. It used to be BB&T Field, now it's Truist Field, but the same great things are gonna be happening here once everybody comes back. So, as you can see on the ground, we've got markers saying which way to go. So, obviously, if you were going into the stadium, you would go up this way, and if you were coming out to go to the concession stand, you would follow this line. Same thing like you're dealing with in the stores right now, same thing applies here at Truist Field. So make sure you look at the ground, look at the signage around you, and it's gonna tell you which way to go, the rules to follow. That way you are staying socially distant and compliant with everything that needs to go on to get you back here at Truist Field. And as you can see around you, we don't have any fans right now, but we've got the seats covered with tarps, just showing our Wake Forest spirit so we can get ready for a primetime game day today. We are so excited to get you back to Truist Field, but given the circumstances, we're gonna do everything we can virtually here so you can, you know, take in all of the feeling of a Demon Deacon game day. Now let's go see those D-clones. So we are here in our premium D-clone section. As you saw earlier on College Game Day, a lot of these cutups were up on the hill behind everyone on the stage. And now we have moved them over to the east side of Truist Field, right behind where the Clemson Tigers visitors bench will be. So throughout the primetime game, make sure you take a look to see who you can see in our D-clone section. We've got Jennifer Richwine here, we've got Arnold Palmer, we've got some pets throughout, and just make sure to take a look and see all of the different Demon Deacon fans. We've had over 1,000 submissions to be a part of our premium D-clone section. And if you would like to be a part of this, you can go to godeeks.com/cutouts and you will be able to submit your picture and be a part of this premium section. Alrighty, back to you, Ty.
Thank you, Brianna. Definitely, we miss you all here. It's definitely, this house is not a home without you guys and the fans. And I know the Deacons miss you guys as well. In this press box, many, many years ago, I actually walked up here and saw Mike Golick. Wake Forest took on Purdue. It's kind of always fun to see the type of personalities that the press box would bring. Right now they have Sean McDonough, who's just a couple rows behind me. So when you think about the broadcasting and how what it means, and especially in this COVID-19 era, we chatted with Stan Cotton, who also chatted with Don Munson, the voice of the Tigers, kind of had a chat about what's he been going through.
And it is great to be here with my longtime friend, the voice of the Tigers, Don Munson. Don, man, I wasn't sure we'd get here. Were you?
No, and I'm just glad to be here. I mean, just I'm thankful for every day that I get now, and I'm going to be thankful for every game that we get here in 2020.
You know, it's been more these days, hadn't it, Don, about quarantine and quarterback and testing more than tight end. And you and I have both done this a long, long time. There isn't anything even remotely we can compare this to, is there?
No. I mean, I would, you know, just going back and looking at history, I mean, everybody's gone back to, you know, 1918, 1919, really the Spanish flu at that time, or that pandemic that hit the world, really started in late 1917, and it was carried by the guys that were fighting in World War One. You know, so really, other than that, maybe the only other thing that I would say that could even relate to it would be the World War II, when the Rose Bowl, you remember that was moved to Durham? They actually played it at Duke in 1942, so those are about the only two things I can really say that, okay, those really are had an effect upon college sports the way that this has.
Well, tell me about the Clemson Tigers. You come in, you know, familiar spot for you guys, right? Number one in the country. You got a couple of Heisman Trophy guys, Coach Sweeney. You guys have it rolling like nobody else in the country.
Yeah, I mean, arguably, Stan, we have the two best guys in college football, and they're in the same offensive backfield, and they stand side by side, and Trevor Lawrence and Travis Etienne. But this is a team that's obviously much more than just those two. They're young at wide receivers, so we're going to see those wide receivers grow up a little bit today. For instance, Joseph Ngata, Frank Ladson, number 10 and number 2, probably should be folks from the Wake standpoint you need to be on the lookout for. They both had pretty good freshman campaigns. Both of them are expected to have much better sophomore campaigns. No Justin Ross, obviously, in the Clemson lineup at all this year because of the spinal cord injury that he had. He's fine, by the way. Looks really good. Been seeing him at practice, and he's walking around, doesn't even have a neck brace on, so doing really well from that standpoint. Then over on the defensive side, even though James Skowski won't start in the first half, he had the targeting call that was on him in the second half of the national championship game, so he won't play first half, which means that young Jake Venables will get a start. So Brent's son will get the start at middle linebacker, and then his younger brother, Tyler, who's a true freshman on this team, you could see him some at that nickelback position, and it wouldn't shock me that maybe to see both Venable boys on the field at the same time at some point this ball game.
Don, national television audience tonight. Game day was here earlier today. Big stage, but no fans as we can continue to talk about the crazy times we're in. Just real quickly, how does Clemson look at this game? I mean, you know, Wake's excited to have the Tigers here. All the eyes and ears of the country on this game with Clemson here. How do the Tigers look at this one real quickly, and we'll be through?
Well, you know, they look at this as the opener. Team goal number one for Clemson football is win the opener. They have five team goals, and number one is win the opener. Coach Sweeney's been pretty good in his opener since taking over on a full-time basis. I believe he's 10-1 in opening games. So that's the way they look at it. It's, you know, it's the opener to this 2020 season. They want to get out. They want to get rolling. They want to kind of show a little bit about what they are about. And I expect Clemson to come in and play pretty well.
Don, we'll leave it there. Have a great call. Best of luck to the Tigers, kind of, sort of. And we'll see you down the road, my friend.
No, I understand. It's always play well in these games. Not good luck, but play well. Same to the Demon Deacs.
The sportsmanship between the voice of the Deacons and the voice of the Tigers. When we come back, we'll have an interview with Dave Clawson. So stay with us.
What do I do when my love is away? Does it worry you to be alone? How do I feel at the end of the day? Are you sad 'cause you're on your
Finish strong. Start here. Wake Forest Baptist Health, Orthopedics and Sports Medicine.
We're back here, Grove Stadium. Now it's Truist Stadium. Going back to my childhood days, of course. Stan had a nice little interview with Coach Clawson. I'm sure he'll talk about the new captain, Sam Hartman. Stan?
Well, a sack this Saturday night will be against one of the better quarterbacks in the country, arguably the best, maybe, Coach. Your take on Mr. Lawrence and what you will see trying to chase him around and get him on the ground.
I mean, you run out of adjectives. I think if there was an NFL draft now, I think he's pretty much the consensus first pick. He's got great arm strength. He's accurate. He's a really good athlete. He's a competitor. He's a winner. You look at his record as a starter. And I think the other thing that's really impressive about him is what a good spokesperson he's been for all of college football the last few months. This is a player that we, you know, not just respect his abilities, his physical talents, but you know, he's got the makeup of a winner, and we have great respect for him as a football player and, you know, what he's done to help the ACC and college football over the last few years.
And in terms of his play, Coach, I think maybe his running ability kind of goes under the radar. I mean, he's a big, tall guy, big, long strides, but he's very effective running the ball, isn't he?
And he's not scared to run it. And you know, if there's a red zone play, a third down play, a fourth quarter play, the game's on the line, he's going to have his hands on the ball, and he's not scared to make plays with his legs. He's not scared to take a hit to get that extra yard. This young man plays the game the way it's meant to be played.
Of course, across the field from him on your sidelines will be Sam Hartman. And again, we're going to talk to Sam. Well, we talked to him yesterday. Going to let folks listen into that at around 7:30 or so, bottom of the hour. But elected captain, obviously, Coach, and he's gained a lot of weight since we saw him first a couple of years ago. And he'll need that, I think. I mean, you know, a quarterback in your offense takes a lot of hits, and so I think that's good, and he's had a great fall camp from all indications. So just a word or two about him as he becomes the starting quarterback for you for the second time, really, after his freshman year two seasons ago.
Yeah, I mean, he's gained weight, strength, arm strength, speed, maturity, leadership skills. This is a totally different person and player than the Sam Hartman who started for us in 2018. He really wasn't ready to be our starting quarterback then. He was kind of forced into battle a little bit because of other things that happened off the field that year. This year he's ready. He's ready to play, and I think play at a really high level.
You were able to save a year for him last year. You got him in those four games, but what do you think last year, Dave, did for him, getting him ready for, again, 2020?
Well, I think when you win the job and then lose it, you have even a greater appreciation for having the job. But, you know, when we brought Sam in, we were really hoping to redshirt him the first year, and we had Kendall Hinton. And really the plan was that he would watch Kendall, for a year in redshirt, And then Kendall would have a second year, and then Sam would be able to compete for the starting job. And it didn't exactly work out that way. He played and then redshirted. But I think last year, learning what he didn't do the year before and the preparation that goes into it and just how important practice is and the value of a rep. When you're a true freshman and show up and all of a sudden you're the starter, it's hard to have an appreciation for winning the job when it happened that easily. And I think now he really values the role he has, the position he has, and even his leadership ability, the impact that he can have on the receivers, the quarterback room, the running back room, and even the O-line room. So I'm really pleased with his development, his maturity, and the fact that he's elected captain, I think speaks volumes for how far he's come.
I think I could speak for all Deacon fans that we saw a leader in Sam Hartman his freshman year, the way he started at 2,259 yards passing and 16 touchdowns. I mean, that's pretty amazing stat for a captain. He just wants the ball. I tell you who's going to give him the ball is Suleiman Kamara and also Boogie Basham. We got a chance to speak with them on the quad walk. Jay Billis has his 94 feet. We got our own, the quad walk.
Yo, this is Sue Kamara from Richmond, Virginia, fifth year senior.
Yo, this is Boogie Basham from Roanoke, Virginia, fifth year senior, and this is Across the Quad.
So, dude, bro, in the locker room, who you think is the best DJ when we that be playing music with?
Honestly, I say myself. You know, I got different flavors.
Yeah.
You know, after awakening, practice, either I just a little workout, you know, guys are in that hype. So I feel like I do a great job of mixing and matching the music for different guys on the team, honestly.
Yeah, that is true. I can give you that one. You pretty good DJ. You know, you turned us up this morning, too.
Yeah.
And the indoor, I like that. Got me a little hype to go. You do got a lot of flavor. So, I mean, I give you that one. I think you, all right, you top two best DJs on the team.
I'll take that.
Yes, sir. But when you think about it, bro, the way we bond off the field, how do you think that is for the whole team? Like,
I mean, personally, when it comes off the field, I feel like we're not really teammates. We're more like brothers.
Yeah.
Because, you know, guys are always hanging around, you know, doing different things together. You know, you never see just one guy just doing something.
That's true.
You know, before COVID, we was been able to, you know, interact with each other more, yeah. But now we've been limited. So it's kind of just playing the game and seeing each other in practice and in class. So I feel like the bond pretty straight myself, though.
Yeah, I mean, the bond is great, man. I know since we came in here, we bonded like crazy. You know what I mean? Even though we knew each other way before we even got here, though, you know, our bond grew stronger than ever. And I mean, especially from even with Isang, Greg, you know, Malik and all them.
Even the guys that left, you know,
exactly,
still cool with
them. And we still cool with them to this day. So that just shows how crazy the bond is off the field, man. That's crazy.
But honestly, though.
Yeah?
What would you say your favorite memory is since we've been here?
Favorite memory? Ooh, that's a tough one. It's just too many, bro. I mean,
you gotta pick one though. At least you gotta pick one.
I can say winning the bowl game, the first bowl game. Right. You know, seeing that the squad went from a 3-9 season and then they came back the next year. You know, and we got our first glimpse of a real championship. You know, and that motivated us to come back the following years to do big things. You know, and look where we at now. So I'll say that first bowl game, probably one of my best memories.
I say my best memory is definitely last year winning the Big Four.
Yeah.
First time in Wake history, you know, blew them all out.
Yeah.
On our home field, you know, it don't get no better than that.
It don't. I love that.
Yeah.
So, all right now. Best part about being on campus.
After a win, you come out here in the quad, you see toilet paper everywhere, rolling the quad, you know. That's just something you don't see too much on all other campuses and every day. So when I first seen it, I was like, that's really fire. You know, I really like it. So it's just something different, kind
of. Definitely one of the best parts about being on campus, you know, after a big win and pulling up and seeing all the students, you know, cheering for us and stuff. You know. So looking back at all this, book, after everything that we've been through here, what is one thing that you would tell your freshman self?
My freshman self, I would say, take the time to soak in everything rather than trying to rush everything. Pretty much with classes and football, being frustrated, not playing,
Yep.
So I would say to myself, just let time take itself, and then pretty much just go with the flow and do what you gotta do while you're here.
Shoot, I agree with you. Every word you just say, man, just enjoy it, man. Cause you know, you only get these 4 years. Maybe you might get a fifth year, you know what I mean? Depending. You only get it once, you know?
Yeah.
So enjoy it, man. That's the biggest thing I tell myself. Just enjoy every bit of it. You know, sell out every play on the football field and just enjoy the bonds with your brothers. Yep. You feel me?
Feel it.
Thanks for checking out Across the Crowd with us, guys. You know, make sure y'all check us out this Saturday, 7:30 at Truist Field.
ABC, you can't miss it.
Go Deeks.
Well, Clemson has an inexperienced offensive line, so I know Boogie Basham Jr. and Suleiman Kamara are going to give them fits. Let's hope, right? We're about an hour away from kickoff. Let's check in on the dance team and their performance earlier. Apparently that was done last night or the night before. Anyway, we're back here at Truist Field. That was the dance team. We're going to toss to break, but stay with us. We got a lot more coming up.
We resolve to do more. To listen, understand, and act. To make healthcare simpler. To nourish our communities. And stand against racism. To see that people get the care they need. Now and in the future. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of North Carolina. We resolve to make healthcare better.
Deacon fans, show your Deacon pride and shop Wake Forest Demon Deacon merchandise and apparel. Stop by any of our concession locations here in the stadium or visit any of our three stores, including the Haynes Mall Deacon Shop, conveniently located just 4 miles from campus. Don't forget, you can also shop 24/7 at WFUstores.com. Go Deacs!
Back here at Deacon Tower, getting ready for kickoff here at Truist Field. Wake Forest taking on the number one team, the Clemson Tigers. Ty Collins, so glad you guys are here virtually. Stan Cotton also had a chance to speak with Dave Clawson. One thing to address is the offensive line, because Justin Heron, of course, now is in the NFL. So, Coach went to tell the fans a little bit how they were adjusting and who to look for. And this season,
let's get a question in here from the email. Logan says, Coach, with losing 3 5th-year senior offensive linemen last week, how are things shaping up in the trenches for Saturday night and the rest of the year?
I mean, I feel really good about it. I mean, we're, we got Zach Tom back, who to me is an all ACC caliber offensive lineman. He'll move to tackle. You have Sean McGinn and Loic Nia, who both played a lot of football last year. Michael Juergens, I think, had a really good offseason and is a really smart, highly intelligent, tough physical football player. Tulane Serena's back, who I think will give us some really important depth, and we'll get him in there. And then Javionte Nash is a fifth-year senior that played, but was behind some really good players for a lot of years, and he finally gets his opportunity to start. And then we got a lot of good young players behind him, you know, Devontae Gordon, Alan Rapplier, C.J. Elmenus. They don't have experience like that last group had, but I think overall we'll end up with a good offensive line again.
What do you think the biggest adjustment for Zach Tom is going to be moving out outside like that?
Well, I'd say this. When you play tackle, it's easier mentally, but harder physically. We ask our center to do a lot. He has to ID the defense and get people on the same page. And there's a lot of mental gymnastics with playing center. A lot of defenses don't cover the center. We play a lot of even front teams. So there's a lot of combination blocks and who you're working to or back blocks. Tackle, you draw the other team's left tackle, you draw the other team's best pass rusher. And so you play in a lot more space. And that's where Zach's athleticism, just like Justin Herron was a really good athlete, Zach is one of the best athletes we've ever recruited on the O-line here. And his skill set is a good fit for that. I think he'll do a great job for us.
With what you were talking about, the center has to do. How you feel about Michael Juergens? I mean, he's been around for, 3 years now? And, so he's, he knows what's expected of him. How do you feel about him?
He's ready. He's ready to be the starter, and he's ready to play, and he knows what he's doing, and he'll play at a high level. I feel really good about Michael. And he's a really hardworking football player. It's important to him. He watches a lot of film. And I'd say the other offensive linemen have great confidence in Michael to get us on the same page.
Losing all that leadership that you had there, what's it been like watching this group? Because there's so many moving parts in an offensive line group. These guys gelling and, becoming, able to play as a unit. How's that come?
Yeah, we have a really good culture on our offensive line. And I think the Beef Boys group with Justin Herron and Phil Haynes and Ryan Anderson and Patrick Osterhage and Jake Benzinger and Nate Gillum, they established such a good culture in the O-line that when they graduate, that culture doesn't graduate with them. And I think for Zach and Michael and Loic and Sean and all those guys to see how Justin and Jake and Nate went about their business, these guys are mature beyond their years, and they know what our standard is in that room. They know the teamwork involved. They know the film study that's involved. And like I said, we lost some good players, but fortunately for us, I think those left a great legacy and established a really healthy culture in our offensive line room.
The Beef Boys tradition continues. A tradition also Wake Forest is developing offensive linemen. You look back at the years of Phil Haynes, Joe Looney, Steve Justice, Steve Vallos, and how can you not forget Michael McCrary? Zach Tom, though, has now moved to the left tackle position. A new position for him because, if you remember, he played center. We got a chance to chat with him in our segment called Behind the Helmet.
I mean, I miss being around the team and being around my friends. That's probably what I miss most about it, the interactions you had with teammates. I'm most excited about being able to play Duke, UNC, NC State. It's for a chance to continue our run at beating North Carolina schools and being able to run the state. I guess to fly. I mean, that would be pretty cool to just be able to fly around like a bird. I can make some steak, but I can grill some steak, and I can make a little something. I can make jambalaya.
He's right. Who wouldn't want to fly, right? That would be my pick if I wanted a superpower. Well, we come back. Stan will again chat with Coach Clawson, talk shop. But we're glad you're here with us virtually here for the season ticket virtual pregame show.
What do I do when my love is away? Does it worry you to be alone? How do I feel at the end of the day? Are you sad 'cause you're on your own? I don't get sad no more. I'm getting by with a little help from my friends. Oh, I'm gonna try with a little help from my friends. Oh, 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 oh,
finish strong. Start here. Wake Forest Baptist Health, Orthopedics and Sports Medicine.
Welcome back here at Truist Field. See Trevor Lawrence on the sideline with Travis Etienne. They get ready to do battle for the Wake Forest Demon Deacons. Coach Clawson, he wanted to chat with him more about the keys to the game. We talked about their inexperience in the offensive line for Clemson and also for their secondary. Let's see what Coach Clawson had to say and what his keys to the game.
Hello, virtual season ticket holders. First off, thanks so much for your generous contribution and being a part of what is really a unique football season. We appreciate your support, and it's great to be with you. The Clemson Tigers, number one team in the country, and Dabo has done a great job there. They've had double-digit wins, I think, the last 9 years, and this might be the best college football program in the country right now. But it's a great challenge. Our players look forward to this game every year. We have not played well against them the last two seasons. We're disappointed with that, and we're excited that they're our home opener and having game day here. But getting to the technical football part of things, there are some real keys to this game. And I think it all begins with their incredible skill. Trevor Lawrence, Travis Etienne, arguably the best quarterback and running back in the country. And really the keys of this game are we have to limit their backfield explosives. That when Etienne gets the ball, we got to get him on the ground. You know, he's going to have his 6 yard plays, he's going to have his 8 yard plays. We cannot allow the 60 and the 80 yard plays, which he produces, almost on a weekly basis. And the same with Trevor Lawrence. Great, accurate thrower, but a very good athlete. And there's times that we're going to get pressure and there's going to be escape lanes. And if those scrambles become 20 and 30 yard plays, that'll be challenging. So, one of our big goals is we've got to eliminate or minimize what we call the backfield explosives. The second big thing is they have a really effective draw and screen game that they get the ball in the space. and we've got to do a good job of defending space plays against them. Clemson, from the days of Deshaun Watson and even Taj Boyd, have always had great space players. So when they get the ball in space by design, and a lot of that design is with screens and draws, the ability to get the ball on the ground and play another down. And then once we get them in third down, we've got to get off the field in third down. They're such an explosive team that when you get chances to get stops, we've got to make sure on defense that if we can get them in third down, that we capitalize on that down and distance and get the football back. Offensively, the challenge is every bit is the same as the other side of the ball. This has been one of the top defenses in the country the last 4 or 5 years. They're very multiple, extremely talented. They had a number of draft picks a year ago, but this is a team that reloads. We have to execute at a high level. And by execute, I mean this. We cannot turn the football over. That is critical. The second thing is we can't have three and outs. We've got to find ways against these guys of moving the sticks, moving the chains, keeping our offense on the field, keeping their offense off the field. And at some point, we've got to make some explosive plays against them, especially if we can get the ball in the red zone. They're such a tough team to score against. If we get the ball inside the 20, I would say at least 2 out of 3 times we've got to come up with touchdowns. So again, this is a complete football team. It's a great challenge, but we're really excited to be kicking off the 2020 season, and we can't thank you enough for buying your virtual season ticket and being a part of Wake Forest football in 2020. Go Deeks.
Wake Forest in their all-black jerseys and their black helmets. I always think that's the best way to go. All right, now about an hour and, excuse me, about 40 minutes till kickoff. In this case, if this was real time or if this was a normal days, most likely you guys would be getting ready to wrap up your tailgating party, where the red lot, gold lot, blue lot, whatever, and then head into the stadium and get ready for the sights and sounds before the game. I always like to get here extra early just to see who's warming up. But, of course, everybody has their own tradition. Some just like to sit in the parking lot and continue to have fun until the last minute before they rush to their seats. But we're going to go live, keep it right here for warm-ups as the countdown continues till kickoff. The season opener of the 2020 season, number one Clemson Tigers versus the Wake Forest Demon Deacons. There's Sam Hartman. Hey, good news, or maybe you make good omen for Wake Forest fans. You know, the last quarterback in the ACC to give Clemson fits, also named Sam. Sam Howell, last year for the Carolina Tar Heels. There's Sam Hartman chatting with, I guess that might be Dabo Sweeney. But Sam Hartman, who has seen it all, lived it all, through injuries and through even being sick in his high school days, and coming back to where he is now as the starter. Remember him in QB1 Beyond the Lights on Netflix. It was a series where they followed quarterback prospects. He was one featured on there when he went to Oceanside there in Charleston, South Carolina. He followed his coach, Chad Greer, the father of Will Greer. His coach of Davidson Day brought him over there, put up big-time numbers. And he had that long hair, too. He put up long numbers. I said that in the open, and that's true. Maybe his confidence goes to another level when he's rocking the long hair. Maybe, or maybe that's just his COVID-19 cut, and he just decided to keep it. But Sam Hartman, I think a lot of the publications before this season said not much about Sam Hartman. Said, well, where's the question marks for Wake Forest? They lost Jamie Newman, but every Wake fan knew that, well, Sam Hartman was the starter, got hurt, and then Jamie Newman came in, got the starting role, then also got the nod in 2019. But also in 2019, Sam Hartman was also up for the starting position. But brand-new wide receivers, you know, Sage Surratt's gone, Scotty Washington's gone, but you have Donovan Green, who's a product out of Mount Airy. We saw tidbits of him. He got redshirted last year with that new rule, can play three games and get redshirted. But what he did against Syracuse, everybody knows. If you follow Wake Forest, this kid's going to be special. So we look to see him on the outside making Clemson drive or make Clemson pull out their hair, hopefully, Dabo Sweeney. Also, Clemson, their best cornerback, Deron Kendrick, was actually recruited to be a wide receiver, was a wide receiver coming into camp, and then converted into a cornerback. So that's something to keep an eye on. Can Wake Forest exploit an inexperienced secondary? Donovan Green, who was 21 last year, now is number 7. Brand new receiving core. You also have Ja'Cory Robertson, who's the slot. And I'm going to really key in on him just because of the type of experience, and I'm not talking about on the field, but watching Greg Dortch, also watching Kendall Hinton. I expect him to be a factor because Sam Hartman likes to find his slot receiver. Also look for Nolan Gruhl, a four-star recruit, was supposed to go to Wisconsin, comes to Wake Forest, former teammates with Sam Hartman at Davidson Day. During the COVID-19 lockdown, he was actually able to practice with Sam because they, obviously, high school teammates, live in the same proximity. So curious to see how that chemistry will go about. But there's Robertson right there wearing number 5. He wore number 82. So he'll be in the slot position. No more Scotty Washington, of course. So a brand-new look. But an experienced quarterback with Sam Hartman. And he also has Kenneth Walker, who may not be said as a starter returning, but we all know what Kenneth Walker did last year. And a lot of these teams will realize how good of talent he is. receivers warming up. Speaking about that slot position, just kind of give you an insight on how that slot position has been for Wake Forest. In the last three seasons, it has averaged about 95.7 receptions, 1,233 yards, and 9.7 touchdowns. That was, of course, by the works of Greg Dortch and Kendall Hinton, as well as Tabari Hines. So the type of offense that Wake Forest puts on the field, they're going to rely on that spot just going by those numbers. Another one to look for is Taylor Morin, a freshman. Also play slot. You most likely will see him at kick return as well as punt return. And, of course, A.T. Perry, a very tall wide receiver. That'd be a big target for Sam Hartman. 6'5", 190 for his season high in snaps was 37 in the Pinstripe Bowl. Included that 28-yard catch to convert a third and long. So A.T. Perry, I know, has not a lot of experience, but has been in some games. So you can't quite rule him out and say it's completely wipe out fresh start on the wide receiving side. Just the way that Sam Hartman likes to throw the ball, they're going to get a lot of action. Also look for Chapman, the tight end, to get a lot. Well, we're going to have a lot more coming up. We're going to take a break from warm-ups. Stay with us.
We resolve to do more, to listen, understand, and act, to make healthcare simpler, to nourish our communities, and stand against racism, to see that people get the care they need, now and in the future. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of North Carolina, we resolve to make healthcare better.
Demon Deacon fans, show your Deacon pride and shop Wake Forest Demon Deacon merchandise and apparel. Stop by any of our concession locations here in the stadium or visit any of our three stores, including the Haynes Mall Deacon Shop, conveniently located just 4 miles from campus. Don't forget, you can also shop 24/7 at WFUstores.com. Go Deacs!
Live look at Truist Field. You're watching the Deacon season ticket virtual pregame show. Your host Ty Collins here, giving you the sights and sounds of what it would be like if we were allowed to have fans here. We truly do miss you, because it's really not the same without the fans in the stands. But if we can somehow bring that to you virtually, the comfort of your own home, that's our goal here. We'll transition more into warm-ups. We want to kind of give you an insight of what's going on the field, because that's what I would be doing right now if I was playing. If I was here, I'm going to be straight front row watching to see who's warming up, who's who, who's dressed, who's not. So we'll go ahead and pitch it down back to the field so you can experience for yourself. kickoff. Kenneth Walker getting some touches before he gets ready to start things off. They kick it off. At kickoff time is at 7:44. While we have some time, just to tell you some scores around the league. Florida State leading Georgia Tech in the second quarter, 10-0. Pittsburgh beat Austin Peay, 55-0. Campbell and Georgia Southern are tied 20-20. Notre Dame earlier, the number 10 Fighting Irish, had some problems with Duke. They won 27-13. North Carolina and Syracuse, it was tough all the way to about the third quarter, and then Carolina broke loose 31-6 in the final there. Appalachian State, and the all they could handle with Charlotte 49ers, they win 35-20. West Virginia 56, Eastern Kentucky 10. Of course, our kickoff live on ABC with Sean McDonough and Todd Blackledge. A kickoff at 7:44, so tune in on your television sets. Last practice in before they will take on the number one Clemson Tigers. It's 2018, Trevor Lawrence at his second career start. His first career start was the week before against Syracuse. Remember, he got hurt, so he didn't quite finish it. But he did finish the year 2018. Going into that game, a lot of Wake Forest fans said this is the time to get Clemson. Didn't quite realize what kind of talent Trevor Lawrence is, most likely the number one pick in the 2021 NFL draft. Dabo Swinney has won 30-31 in his 12 years at Clemson. 29 consecutive regular season wins. And now it's 29 consecutive regular season wins. Our last regular season loss was October 13, 2017. That was at Syracuse. They lost 27-24. Wake Forest went 8-5 last year, 7-1 going into Virginia Tech. But that's when those key injuries really started showing themselves, because didn't have a lot of injuries overall, but the injuries that Wake Forest suffered were to their best players. Remember Sage Surratt going down early in the first quarter against Virginia Tech. Wake Forest went on the last six game going 1-5, losing in the Pinstripe Bowl. It's a new game, new slate for 2020. Of course, they kick things off against the number one team in all the land, the Clemson Tigers. I'll back away and let you enjoy the Nat sounds of what's going on in the gridiron as both teams prepare for kickoff in about 40 minutes. 2020 season for Wake Forest will begin. You ask Everett what time he's coming.
Thank you.
Deacon's preparing. Also preparing is the starter and the captain, Sam Hartman. It's featured on QB1 Beyond the Lights on Netflix. Well, now he's back at QB1. Stan Cotton had a chance to speak with Sam on his, well, it's actually his being the title of captain of this team.
We work you through Wake Forest and Clemson. Wake Forest starting quarterback will be, as we've talked about, and as everybody knows, Sam Hartman, and we caught up with him yesterday. Sam, thank you for your time. I know being a starting quarterback for a college football team, a lot of folks are after you, right? I mean, how many interviews do you think you've done in the last, I don't know, 2-3 weeks?
It'd be up there a lot, I would say, plus 10. But, you know, it's part of the job, and, you know, trying to take it in as I can. And it's an honor and opportunity because I know a lot of people would love to be doing this and, you know, being able to play, you know, quarterback at Division I level. It's an honor, and, you know, with it comes some responsibilities and some privileges, and just trying to take advantage of, you know, all of them.
How would you compare Sam Hartman today compared to the young freshman who started a couple of years ago? You're grinning. No one can see you but me, but you've got a smile on your face right now.
Yeah, I think there's just, you know, miles and miles of differences, and the maturity is probably the biggest thing. I think, you know, you come in as a freshman and, you know, you get blessed with the opportunity to play, and people have been telling you, you know, your whole freshman spring, you're going to redshirt, and then you end up, you know, starting quarterback, headed down to Tulane. And I think it was just some missed opportunities throughout that whole season of, I would say, preparation was very lacking, and just not really knowing what it takes to win a, you know, a Power 5 football game. And, you know, going into this year from last, and then especially from last year, just learned a lot about, you know, what it takes, and watching 12 do his thing, and then, you know, coming in a couple of those games, it really taught me a lot about just being patient, and, you know, when the opportunity's there, just seizing the moment. So I think that's probably the biggest thing, is just the maturity level of realizing the opportunity at hand, and just trying to capitalize on this moment that we're going to have on Saturday.
You said it was an honor to be a starting quarterback at this level. Your teammates have elected you captain. What does that mean to you?
Again, I mean, it's just, you know, using the word honor pretty lightly, but I mean, it's just, it's really a blessing of, you know, having those guys believe in me. And it's, you know, it's a lot of hard work put into just hours and hours of, you know, watching film and, you know, trying to lead guys, you know, in days you don't feel great, and I'm sure they don't feel great. It's just being able to push guys. And it's a cool moment when they, you know, say, hey, you're a captain. And then just throughout the season, there's just a lot of opportunities to, you know, take over and step up and lead these guys. But again, just, it's a huge honor, and just been trying to soak it in as much as I can.
There he is. Thank you.
Thank you.
We're back here in our Deacon Tower studios, and we have the blessing of having the AD here, the athletic director, John Curry, who's here and is back from back in Winston-Salem since, what, 2000?
So I departed in 2000, August of 2000, and I returned in March of 2019. So I was gone for 19 years, and it has just been incredible to come back into this community to see the progress that we've had, both in the city of Winston-Salem and certainly at Wake Forest. And, you know, I'm the luckiest guy in the world to be able to be here right now.
Definitely. Sure, you wanted to say hello to your mom?
My mom is watching. She is a subscriber of the Deacon Virtual Season Ticket. So, Mom, I have my mask on. She's a stickler for the masks. So thank you very much, Reverend Gray, for making sure we wear our masks.
That's good. That's good. So I got to ask you, you got to August 9th. I'm in my bathroom giving my four-year-old the bath, and I'm getting all these texts about what's going on in the college football world. Everything's pandemonium, right? How did we get here?
Well, we got here because of the courage of some leaders. And I want to talk a little bit about some of those names specifically. And we also got here because our student athletes not only said they wanted to play, but they proved they wanted to play. Just like Wake Forest students in general said they wanted to come back and have residential learning and live in the dormitories and go to real classes. And they've proven thus far that was possible. So, but from a leadership standpoint, Nathan Hatcher, our president, who has been a really pivotal leader for not just the ACC, but the NCAA when he chaired the NCAA Division I Board of Directors. But then more recently, he was among a couple presidents that really counseled patience, counseled perseverance, that we didn't have to give up. And there was that day, I guess that was the Monday, August 9th, somewhere in that range, where there was that moment was the first moment that morning that I was like, I'm not sure this is going to work, because we knew the Big Ten and the Pac-10 were gonna throw in the towel. We thought the Big 12 might, and that was going to put a lot of pressure. The case counts are rising, and there was some leadership, some incredible leadership from Dr. Hatch and Commissioner Swofford and others in our league. And speaking of leadership, we're blessed. He's not on camera because we have to be socially distanced, but Gerald Roach, who's the chairman of the board of Wake Forest University, is right behind us. And so from the board level at Wake Forest, we are so lucky to have the kind of engaged leaders that we have that has provided the support for President Hatch to put together a great cabinet. And we've got just tremendous faculty and our faculty and staff under our Provost Rogan Kirsch, the Dean of the College, Michelle Gillespie. Our faculty and staff, you know, they didn't take the summer off. They were working all summer developing how to teach in the classroom with more flexibility and online modules and all that kind of stuff. And it's remarkable that they have dedicated themselves so much to enabling students at Wake Forest to be back in the classroom this fall.
So with you scrambling to get somewhat of a, you know, ACC schedule for football, now you get word that College Game Day is going to come here, first time ever. 33 years. What was that like?
It was very exciting. You know, Will Pantages, who's our associate AD for communications, he was actually the first person they called to say they wanted to do some site selection. And they were asking some feasibility stuff. And, you know, certainly we had articulated long ago and through the years, and I'm sure Ron did before me and others have done, that we wanted Game Day to come to Wake Forest. And it was really neat how it kind of came together. And then the hardest part of it is that we were supposed to keep it secret until last Saturday, a week ago, because they were announcing it on that show Saturday morning. But there's all this stuff that has to happen to get ready for it. And to do what we did in the bowl, to do what we did at the fairgrounds with the drive-in experience, all the different elements that we wanted to do to make it special, we had to work through all those things in a very delicate, sensitive way. So I'm really proud of our staff. And really, it's not just the athletic staff. It's staff across the university. You know, we distributed over 3,500 free T-shirts for Wake Forest students this week. We had the bus on campus, the game day bus. And if you think about our students really having to be focused on distance and safety and stuff like that over the last couple of weeks, it was really neat to see some of those students coming out of the dorms, lining up socially distanced, of course, and stand in front of that game day bus to take a picture of themselves that they could then send to their friends whose colleges haven't been able to get them back on campus and in their own campus. So it was a great moment for those students.
It is definitely a great moment. It's a staple for all college football fans to turn on their television and have College Game Day live here in Winston-Salem. Right. Is just beyond me. It's astonishing. So you go back to 2008, you were at Tennessee, and, of course, Dave Clawson was the offensive coordinator. How is, to you, Dave Clawson, your relationship? Had a great coach, his offensive mind. Tell me a little bit about that.
Well, Coach Clawson and I first met each other in the spring of 2008 when he came to Tennessee, and obviously that season didn't go very well for lots of reasons. Then we came in good. We continued to stay in touch when he went to Bowling Green. And I remember calling Ron after he made the decision to hire Dave Clawson here at Wake Forest, and I knew he had made an incredible hire and congratulated him, and I was so happy for Wake Forest and for Dave and Catherine and their family because it's really a perfect match. And if you look at our program now where we are, four consecutive bowl games, having a 990 APR and a 97 APR, 990 graduation rate, all this kind of stuff is really he represents everything that Wake Forest is about. And our student athletes in football, in all of our sports, and certainly football is no exception, are incredibly committed to their studies and graduate at a high rate. And obviously they've turned out to be a pretty good football program as well. So very pleased that this has been a perfect marriage for both Wake Forest and Coach Clawson.
That's great. Well, I tell you, real quickly before we say goodbye, you're a proud Demon Deacon graduate. How is it now becoming the AD?
Well, it's a lot of fun, but it's also an enormous responsibility, right? There's so many great things going here, and it's my job to make sure they stay going great, but also accelerate. And one of our goals from an athletics perspective and really a university perspective is I think when as we come out of the COVID pandemic era, whenever that may be, right? It may be months, it may be years. We're determined that we're going to come out of that era at a dead sprint. We're not going to stumble out into the light and then try to figure out where we're doing. So all of our staff, our contributors, our ticket holders, the Deacon Virgil season ticket holders who've adopted a new technology for the first time ever in this format, we're going to come out of this. We're going to make it through it. We're going to do the very best we can in it. And when we come out, we're coming at a dead sprint. This is not slowing us down at Wake Forest. And I think the things that have been shown that could be done here, you know, goes back to that Wake will, you know, a philosophy of figuring out how to get it done and continue our pro humanitate mission.
We're going to be at a dead sprint coming up here shortly when we take on Clemson. So we got more coming up after the break. Athletic Director John Curry, thank you for joining us.
Thanks, Doc.
What do I do when my love is away? Does it worry you to be alone? How do I feel at the end of the day? Are you sad 'cause you're on your own? I don't get sad no more. If I would need help from my friends, oh, I'm gonna try with you.
Hey Demon Deacon fans, show your Deacon pride and shop Wake Forest Demon Deacon merchandise and apparel. Stop by any of our concession locations here in the stadium or visit any of our three stores, including the Haynes Mall Deacon Shop, conveniently located just 4 miles from campus. Don't forget, you can also shop 24/7 at WFUstores.com. Go Deacs!
Looking live right there at Deacon Hill. And that sure is a staple to all Wake Forest Demon Deacon fans. Going back to my childhood days and rolling down the hill. I'm sure that is now policeable a little bit different, but I was there last year right at the wall when Kendall Hinton caught that unbelievable pass against Utah State to get the win. You see the cutouts there for try to make it look at least like there's people in the stands because nobody's allowed in due to the pandemic that is going around with COVID-19. About 20 minutes away from kickoff. The lights are on. An overcast day with some rain. Hoping those clouds would move away, but still hovering. Forest in their final preparations before they kick off with the Clemson Tigers. Clawson had his keys to the game, and I'm sure Stan will have his. I guess in my own opinion, if you want keys to the game, I'm going to say if they can keep the defensive line for Wake Forest, if they can keep bringing in more players and just pound that inexperienced offensive line and give Trevor Lawrence problems, I think they might see some success and might just stun the Clemson Tigers tonight. Hey, Chris Paul said Wake Forest is going to stun them. And if Chris Paul says it, I think I'm going to believe it too, right? But Wake Forest, a last preparation before they hit the gridiron with Clemson. See what the new offensive line will do for Wake Forest. They bring only two starters back. And from Clemson, of course, like I said, they're inexperienced in that department. All brand new wide receivers. Chapman at the tight end. In this type of offense, that tight end is a key component to getting success. Chapman is very athletic and very big. Remember, he's studied under Cam Sarigné, so all ACC, that's someone you want to study up.
All right, Demon Deacon fans, get on your feet as we sing and clap along to Here's to Wake Forest. Thank you. Please stand and join the oldest marching band in North Carolina by singing the Wake Forest University alma mater, conducted by drum majors Courtney Craven and Katie Wooten. Deacon fans, shout it out as we celebrate the greatest university of all, Wake Forest University. It's time for the Deacon drum beat. Spell it out with us.
Things started. It's Wake Forest welcoming in the Clemson Tigers, the number one Clemson Tigers. We thank you for taking the time to stop by here in our Deacon Tower studios, because you guys could be anywhere in the world, but you're here with us getting ready for college football, and we do miss you because it really is not a home without the fans. We miss seeing the people run around in the stands, seeing them Deacon Hill. Everybody with that anticipation of what could be an historic night here at Truist Field. So we do truly miss you guys from the bottom of our heart. And we do appreciate you understanding the safety precautions that Wake Forest has done to make sure that we can have a college football season. Right now we're going to go back to what's going on the field. As again, as I said, only been less than 10 minutes away till we get this thing started.
University of Alabama. what's up, danger? Like, what's up, danger? Don't be a stranger.
Moments away from game one of the 2020 season. So for my crew, John Curry, Athletic Director, Stan Cotton, Brianna Norwood, I'm Ty Collins. We appreciate you guys being here with us on the virtual ticket. We wish you guys were here in person, but we're glad you are here virtually. As we get ready to turn on to ABC, Sean McDonough with the call for Wake Forest and Clemson. A game that will be down in the history books at a time of a pandemic. We are back playing football, a time that we thought we may have not have seen. But we're here, and we're glad you get a chance to watch it. Check with us back in 2 weeks when Notre Dame comes here to Winston-Salem.